Welcome, everybody. It is right around that time. Christmas time is coming, but also it's the Schmoedown Spectacular. It's number three. This is by far the biggest event that we have ever done in the Schmoedown, not just by the scale of it, of how many people are going to be here, but the competitors, Mark, that are involved in this one. I mean, it just lined up so perfectly. I don't think you're ever going to get a better event than the one we have coming up here.
The feast that people are about to experience with the Schmoedown Spectacular is every bit as tasty as was that pizza in Anaheim back when we came up with this whole thing. And now it's exploded to be a universal thing. People from Mars are going to tune in and watch this. So what we wanted to do, Kristian and Mark, we wanted to give you a little rundown of everything that you're going to see at the Schmoedown Spectacular. We have no idea who's winning. We have no idea a lot of the entrances. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of surprises that throw us off, but there are some things that we do know.
Well, we know that every title is on the line. We know that there is a very important number one contender match, and there's something that I got thrown into that I'm very excited about, and we'll be able to talk about that in just a moment. But there are things that you can make predictions on. We'll get Mark's predictions on them. You guys can predict on
it. Am I allowed to predict?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, why not? I've done it before, and okay. You know, there you go.
Hey, I'm happy to gamble.
We'll start off, okay? And we'll just start with this Commissioner Bowl. Now, who is this Paulie G character? That's all. For the longest time, we thought that it was Mike Kalinowski that was doing everything, but here's this lawyer, this Paulie G character, who we know if you go back in time and you look at last year's Spectacular, Jason Inman doing an interview, and here's this guy, and he says, there's a revolution coming, Inman. And then at the Schmoedown Awards, there he is again. And if you look, and apparently you can't see it on video, but
I was on stage, idea what the hell was happening.
Well, the live event itself, when Kalinowski and the crew jumped in there, Mike gave himself the shot over Mara Knopic. Paulie G showed up once again, put his hand on Mike's shoulder. So he had revealed himself quite a few times, but then on the phone, he tells Mike, he says, listen, go on in there and tell Thadd to do this. Because Breanne Chandler, by the way, has had enough of this. She had enough. As soon as Mike gave Ken Napzok the shot at the Star Wars title, she said, look, if you don't start saying no to Mike Kalinowski, you're going to have people walk at the Spectacular. You're not going to have people there anymore. Thadd finally says no to Kalinowski. Kalinowski calls Paulie G. Paulie G says, make him challenge me. And he does. And he comes in, he challenges me. I said, sure, you know, I got it. And then Dagnino and Emma are thrown into this thing. So there's your Commissioner Bowl. God help us all. But Dagnino's got a shot against his rival, Emma Fyffe, and then I'm going up against my rival, Thadd Williams, in a four-way for the commissionership. And that letter, by the way, whatever in that envelope,
yeah,
we find out. Or if Thadd wins, we're never going to find out.
Well, Thadd's the real wild card here. Yeah. When I'm looking at this as a movie trivia match, is that I have no idea what the guy knows, what he doesn't know. I know he's a big fan of television. I don't know if that's going to translate into film knowledge.
But he was good in deep cuts. He was good in deep cuts. Him and Aaron Wilhelm, they were 2-1, 2-2. I don't remember, but he was pretty solid.
I was back in like 1993. True. What have you done for me lately? And lately, Emma Fyffe, certainly a great manager, but also I know everything Emma knows, and I know everything Tom Dagnino doesn't know. So he really needs to get luck when it comes to the wheel. Yeah. You're the odds-on favorite in my book, and I will be cheering you on lustily. I think you're going to take it. Thadd and Emma could sneak up. Finstock, I think, is going to finish last, although he may say some entertaining things if he says them loud enough to be picked up by a microphone.
Well, look, it's about time I get this thing back. I'm going to get it back. I'm going to beat Thadd. It'll be fun to beat Dagnino, and then I'll be there with my friend Emma Fyffe in this battle. The reason that the Dagnino Fyffe thing is so special because of last year's Manager Bowl, they went head-to-head, and it was really between Dagnino and Fyffe at the very end, and yeah. Fyffe, of course, won it and forming the Fyffe Club by doing so. But it's also between those two, it's Manager of the Year if you look at it too, because what is going to happen with their two stables? Because that takes us into our next match, and that's match number two. The second match inside of the Schmoedown Spectacular at the end of video one will be for the team championship.
Team title match, 5 rounds to the finish, and you couldn't have asked for two better, maybe two more entertaining teams in the entirety of the Schmoedown.
Same record, both 4-0. Both have 2 knockouts. Both have a little different rise to fame. If you look at first, you look at the champions, Clarke Wolfe and Rachel Cushing. Clarke Wolfe, a legend of the game. Mm-hmm. Just look what she did in the singles. She made it to the finals and just just lost to Ethan by a word.
Yeah.
Could have been playing Rocha for the title, but she's competing twice. Okay, you look at what she has done. She's having an incredible year. She's in the conversation for Player of the Year for sure. And then you have her teammate Rachel Cushing, who is a threat in all three divisions: in Inner Geekdom, in teams, in singles.
Perennial Player of the Year candidate as well. And then you put two of them together on a team. It seems unfair.
It certainly seems that way. If you look at, they beat the Lions then in their debut, then they beat Action at the live event, they TKO'd the World's Finest, and then they knocked out the team of Breanne Chandler and Bald Brian Bishop, the team of Sick in the Head, when Breanne had won her shot from winning the free-for-all. She challenged the Shirewolves. Not the best move, because they were on fire at that point. They win the vacant titles that were made vacant by Above the Line, and they are the dominant champions. However, you now look at this team, and a team that if you told me at the beginning of the season, Ben Bateman, one of the most despicable people in the league, is going to be with one of the most lovable and loved people in the league, the two-time champion, Mark Reilly.
I would have said, Angela, Mona.
This is not going to happen. You said that's impossible. And then partner them up with that louse that I'm going to be going up against, Finstock. It seems like it's crazy, but it has been perfect.
Yeah.
Booker T says perfect. It has been, they have looked dominant. There has not been a team who has gotten close to beating them. They haven't had to answer a five pointer. They TKO'd Corruption, and they knocked out the Harris brothers, who were on a run, in the third round of their five-round final match. They look really solid.
And their team name is Who's the Boss, hence my impressions, by the way. I thought you were going to save me there.
I got it.
You decided not to bail me out. That's fine.
Why would I bail you out? It's an amazing impression.
Oh, thank you, Kristian Harloff.
So
this is my Tony Danza.
Yeah, Adam Ray would be jealous.
Now back to Mark Ellis here. I think that this matchup, it's exciting, too, because you look at Who's the Boss. We know that Clarke and Rachel play off each other so well. They complement each other as teammates when they're up there under the spotlight. Yep. Every match, it seems, Who's the Boss, they get a little more familiar with each other's game. So they're still learning each other. Then as you get into the playoffs, I think that they're going to show a new, maybe even deeper knowledge than they have previously. And like you said, they have not been pushed quite to the limit yet.
Right.
They're going to get pushed to the limit in the spectacular.
Will they ever? Because you look at that last match when Shirewolves won the titles. They played an amazing game. That's the thing, though, that this game has evolved. It's not just about movie trivia. It's how you play the Schmoedown, and they know how to play it. And one of the most emotional post-match interviews we've ever seen, again, to this day. Maybe, on par with the Rocha Murrell interview, but you looked at what happened. Raw emotions with Rachel and Clarke, as they just said, and Clarke, shouting out, "We are the league." And that's what they're going to try to prove on the day of the spectacular. Shirewolves, Who's the Boss for the belts? And one other battle that's happening, like I mentioned, Emma and Finstock, they could argue for who's manager of the year here.
Yeah.
Because I still think Emma's got it slight in favor, because Clarke made it to the finals of the singles. She's had both Rachel and Clarke in singles titles this year. Mark Andreyko had a nice run. I still think Emma's an odds-on favorite to win it, but it certainly wouldn't hurt Finstock's chances if Who's the Boss took the belts.
No, this is really a tough one to call in my head. I woke up this morning thinking Shirewolves. You almost convinced me to go Who's the Boss. I feel like the Shirewolves, it just seems like it's going to be their year. It seems like this is going to be the icing on the cake. And then if I have to go with managerial consulting for the tiebreaker, I certainly am going to take Emma over Finstock. I think that it's going to be tough. They're going to have to answer a five-pointer. And like you said, they never had to answer a five-pointer together before. Maybe this is the one where it doesn't go their way.
Maybe not. But look at this. Look at the experience, right? You have Clarke Wolfe has competed in, this will be her fifth title match of all time. Rachel Cushing has been in, this will be her third. Mark Reilly has been in seven. Ben Bateman has been in zero title matches.
This is
his first title match he's ever been, so you know how much this means to him. He's been screaming, "Where's the belts?" for years.
Yep.
Well, he's going to find out whether he's going to get it. I'm actually going to go with you, my friend. I'm going to go the Shirewolves here, but it's going to be close. It's going to get to that five-pointer, and I think the Shirewolves are going to take the victory.
All right, well, next up is going to be a match for the Galaxies. We're not literally competing for Galaxies here, but it's information about a galaxy far, far away, and it's two of the best that I've ever seen. They're literal human competing. They're downright lobots when it comes to knowing Star Wars, and that is Ken Napzok versus Alex Damon. I don't know that anybody on Earth can beat Alex Damon. If somebody is, it might be Ken Napzok.
This is a sham. This whole thing.
The whole thing's a sham.
This whole thing's a sham. Ken doesn't deserve the spot. He doesn't deserve the spot. He should. Okay. He hasn't won a match since he won the title.
Sure.
He lost it to Whitwer. He lost the triple threat. But because he's associated with Kalinowski, this is essentially why Brienne had the reaction that she did, and it was due. And now he puts himself in this, and this is why we're in the position of the Commissioner Bowl too, because he's overusing. Mike was overusing his power. Now Ken is in here. Sure, does he know his stuff? Yes, he does. He's a former champion. And Damon just looks unbeatable. Now, the only other person I think that really gives Damon a shot is Sam Witwer, but Sam Witwer is not available. Sam Witwer is not around. And Joseph Scrimshaw, I think, should have gotten the shot over Ken. But that's not where we're at.
Ken happens to make alliances with the right people and have free time. So that's why he's competing against Alex Damon tomorrow. But, I love Ken. I'm a fan of his as a human being. I just think that Alex Damon crushes him. I just don't see a lot of even competition in this, although it is important to note this is not going to be the Ironman format that people were expecting.
No, it's a five-rounder.
It's a five-rounder, so it is. The belt is on the line. Alex's belt is on the line. I think that it could get – if Ken gets him – 2-5 rounds, I think that is the achievement. We'll give him a little, like, a mini belt that we got at Ross.
I think that it's going to be a close match, and I think that it's once again going to be movie quotes that does Ken in. He is stubborn. He doesn't want to study movie quotes. Alex Damon knows him like the back of his hand, and I see Damon taking this from Ken as well.
One is going to be Moff Jairdrau. The other one, merely General Veers.
That's video two. That's the beginning of video two. The main event of video two is a main event that could main event spectacular all in itself, and it's a number one contender match. It is Classy Clarke Wolfe right again after either defending or potentially losing the titles, will be playing against the former two-time champion, Dangerous Dan Murrell. But Clarke Wolfe and Murrell have faced each other before. Back in 2016, Murrell was the champion. Clarke was the undefeated challenger during her rookie season. Dan Murrell won that via TKO, but very different career paths since that match. Dan went on to win the championship twice, retired, came back, had a rocky start. Clarke went on to become just an absolute legend in the game, wins the team championship, takes herself all the way to the final. She's coming into this one as the favorite, by the way, because of what, so the way that it all worked in the singles tournament was whoever made it to the finals, the loser of that would automatically be in the number one contender match. Then the two losers of the semifinals would play against one another. That happened to be Mark Andrako and Dan Murrell. Dan Murrell took that victory via TKO, and we get Murrell versus Wolf 2. The stakes couldn't be higher, because not only do they get a chance to play for the singles championship in season premiere of season 6, they do it in New York.
Live on stage in front of probably a lot of your naked steaming eyeballs. In the meantime, with the spectacular, you get a fresh rested Dan Murrell going up against Clarke Wolfe, who will have already competed in 5 grueling rounds possibly earlier that day. Will she be coming off a win? Will she be coming off a loss? I think maybe it's just that mentality could determine the outcome of this match.
100%. If
I'm usually right.
If the Shirewolves have an amazing game, win either by TKO or just Clarke is just on fire and is in game mode, then Dan Murrell is going to have a really rough night. If the Shirewolves either lose or Clarke is a little bit thrown off from the game, then Dan Murrell could take this match fairly easy, or it could just be a scrap from start to finish. Clarke Wolfe is on a roll right now. She was looking unstoppable in that singles tournament. She beat Ben Bateman. She beat her stablemate, Mark Andrako, and she had Ethan dead to rights, but instead of South Side with you, she said South Side with me. Just that
pronouns.
One pronoun.
When I was diagramming sentences in seventh grade.
Exactly. One pronoun, and we would have been talking about Erwin versus Murrell 2 and not Wolf versus Murrell 2. But we are talking about that match. These are two legends of the game playing against each other. This is also something for Clarke, to where I think that Dan Murrell loss back in 2016, the game was different, by the way. Back then, in their first round, Dan got 6 questions of his own. She got 6 questions of her own. She knew all of Dan's questions back then. So this is a different game. They haven't played the 8th round before. This is going to be something to watch. Again, this is a main event any other place except the spectacular.
And it's headlining the second of the 3 spectacular vids that you'll be able to enjoy shortly. And I think I'm going to have, because I've seen firsthand what competing multiple times in a day, what being around, being on hand and having expectations, having responsibilities in a tournament setting or in a spectacular setting can do to people. Saw it happen with you last year. Yeah. You were literally a shell of the normal shell of a person that you are, and it just didn't go your way. Maybe as a result, I fear the same thing with Clarke Wolfe. It's an enduring trial going through five heavyweight rounds and then having to go face somebody like Dan Murrell nonetheless. So I do have Dan Murrell in this, but I think Clarke Wolfe is certainly going to give him a match, and this one will go the distance. You're going to see 2 5-pointers answered, correctly or incorrectly, at the end of this match.
Yeah, I'm just going to go on the other side because of this reason, because I'm predicting the Shirewolves to win, and I think Clark's going to come off feeling well. It's only going to be one match in between for when she gets right back in there. She'll be playing essentially 8 rounds, and she will be going up against Dan. And Dan has had an okay season. Not a great one. Lost against Andrew Guy when he came back.
What the hell? That happened?
In a TKO. His other loss was against Ethan Erwin in a TKO. They had that rough team loss with him and Rocha to Corruption. And they beat Stacey Howard and Winston Marshall at the live event. He beat Andrejko and he beat Stacey Howard. So he's 3-3 this year. And this is going to be overall. And so this is going to be something for him. This is not the dominant, scary Dan Murrell. The league has evolved. I think it's going to be a scrap. I think it's going to be toe-to-toe. But I see Clark just edging it out and seeing her going to New York in January.
If Dan Murrell wins, then you will be seeing scary Dan Murrell again in New York. If Wolf wins, then you're going to have a Wolf live on stage in New York. It's going to be fun either way.
Either way, it's going to be a fun one, and that ends video two. But video three, I mean, you look at the way that this stacks up. My God, this could be the spectacular all on its own. The first match is the Inner Geekdom Championship, a rematch between the challenger, again, maybe someone who didn't necessarily earn it, and Mike the Killer Kalinowski, who will be facing the rookie sensation, the 5-0 champion, Mara Knopic, the amazing Mara Knopic, and what a run by the amazing one. You look at what she did. She enters this tournament that Kalinowski created. She takes out Coy Jandrew. She takes out Emma Fyffe. She beats Rachel Cushing. She beats Mike Kalinowski in the finals, and then she takes out Jason Immonen at the live event to take the title. We have never seen that type of a rise that fast from a rookie and someone who just no one knew who she was. And now, if you watch the Schmoedown, if you don't know who she is, then you're not really a Schmoedown fan.
Yeah. I mean, you don't see dwarf stars that often, and that's what we've gotten with this one. And so her just jetting into the league the way that she has and the style that she has with some of the underhanded panache that she has, because she's got great performance ability, too. Yeah. It's just not as corrupt as Mike Kalinowski, so he gets the bulk of the headlines, but he is the challenger. And that's something to remind everybody, is that I feel like Mike Kalinowski's done a lot for the league. He's done a lot against the league. Did he earn his way in? Sure, fine, I'll give him that. But I'm also going to say you earned your way into the Lions then, because I think Mara is going to be the one coming out of this one with the victory.
Well, it's certainly possible because she has the win over him too. It was a tough match when they fought the first time.
He can't get in her head.
No, absolutely not. 5 rounds, and then it was Mike Kalinowski who now, you know, he says it. Mara beat me fair and square. Mara deserved it. He takes credit for Mara being in the league in the first place, but he says that Mara is the true champion, and he's got to beat the true champion to become the champion.
Any sort of humility we get from Kalinowski should be considered a win by us.
It's the truth, and he has been. She's made him that humble because he wants to beat the rightful champion, to which she is. And so he's going to face her. But what he did was he crashed that live event with Chance Ellison and Ken Napzok.
He usually does.
And he said, guess what? I'm going to abuse my power that I have over Thadd, and I'm going to give myself a title shot. And this was the last thing. This and that Ken Napzok thing are the last two things that Kalinowski was able to do before we nip this whole thing in the bud, and it's going to be overcome spectacular because I'm taking that damn commissionership back. It'll be the end of Kalinowski, I'll tell you that.
I haven't seen you this anxious to get into the ring in a while.
It's like enough is enough.
It really means something.
Enough is enough. Because the two of these guys, they're fighting. I think Kalinowski really wants it badly. I think that first match, he looked really good.
They both are students of the Inner Geekdom game.
But here's the thing. Mara Knopic has had time to study. She is brilliant. Mm-hmm. Not just on the Schmoedown. As a human being, she's smart. She has a photographic memory.
Can't pronounce bagel, but that's okay.
I'm going to be with you here. I'm going to say that Mara Knopic just edges out Mike Kalinowski. Okay. Five-pointer at the very end. All right, and then the main event.
Oh, there's one more?
That's right. Oh. You say WrestleMania 3. You say Schmoedown Spectacular 3. It's Hogan versus Andre. It is the reigning Movie Trivia Schmoedown Champion of the World, the Outlaw John Rocha, defending his championship against the Ultimate Schmoedown singles winner, 6-1, Ethan Big Time Erwin. Wow, what a main event that is.
You say Hogan versus Andre. I prefer more of an Ali Frazier kind of mode, but either way, you get these two in the ring together. What's going to happen? Such a contrast of styles. They both know a lot about movie trivia, but we know John Rocha. He is indeed a legend of the game, maybe the best ambassador the game has ever seen, for better or for worse. He barks a lot. His bite is just as scary as the bark. Then you have Ethan Erwin coming in. He's just coming off. He was hanging out with Bob Downey on a movie set 15 minutes ago, having cappuccino. He just casually waltzes in with his Brooks Brothers attire, sits down, answers virtually every question right, and leaves and goes about on his merry way. Will he be driving his Cadillac out of here successfully, or will John Rocha and the pony ride off into the sunset one more time?
Well, Ethan Erwin is such a scary competitor, because I can't tell you how many times you say the name Ethan Erwin to any competitor in this league and they shake. They get so scared from this guy, because he is the definition of just raw knowledge. Mm-hmm. He goes into this, is everything he knows, where there is a lot of studying done by competitors now, and from the likes of Rachel Cushing to Mara Knopic and Ben Bateman, Breanne Chandler,
Kalinowski.
They've all studied and become phenomenal players. Ethan just knows.
He was born with it.
He doesn't study. He just knows all this stuff. And that's the thing. He just goes into the game. What he knows, and he knows a lot. As where John Rocha has been studying a lot, has been training a lot. He trained very hard to beat Bibiani, and he earned it. He's got the most wins in Schmoedown history, 11 wins. And now here's the other thing. John Rocha was the first player to ever win three games twice in a row. He did it 2 years ago, right. Ethan did it twice this year. As a rookie, he did it twice. And his only loss comes to Mark Andreyko, where he was winning that match, but the children of Peter Pan took him out. Ethan couldn't fly. And what happens now? He's now 6-1. 6-1, though, because he won that tournament. He took out Chance Ellison in a great match, TKO'd Dan Murrell, and then just barely, though, scratched by and beat Clarke Wolfe, and he's earned his shot. But the other factor here is Jay Washington. Jay Washington has been a good luck charm to Ethan Erwin. It's such a strange pairing.
He's a great manager.
He has, strange enough, because Ethan basically told him after that first match, stop with the bad guy bullshit and just be a nice guy. Be with me. You're my good luck charm. Help me out here. Help me with the things I don't know about the game, and let's do this. And they've been doing it, because Jay Washington looks to be the first manager ever to manage a singles player to the world championship.
Yeah, I look at this matchup, and you're right. I think that Jay does play a role in this. I think that he, even though Ethan may not admit it publicly or show it or wear it on his sleeve, he does get a quiet sense of additional confidence from having somebody like Jay around. And you put that up against Rocha. Rocha is somebody that goes through these circumstances, like he missed Bespin or he misses Calvin Klein, and he beats himself up about it, and then he comes back even stronger. Ethan, he's lost a tough match, but it doesn't seem like it bothers him. Right. So it's like Rocha takes everything so personally when he misses a question. Ethan, it just goes off his sleeve. So whose style is going to win here? This is a fight of styles more than it is who knows more about movies, because they both know just about everything there is to know.
It's also about experience, though. That's the thing. Because Ethan Erwin, his first five-rounder ever was against Clarke Wolfe, and he paid the price for it because he was winning the entire match against Clarke.
Do you think endurance might have been a factor?
He wasn't ready for the speed round. Clarke went 4-1 against Ethan in that speed round, and if he does that against Rocha, he's going to be in trouble. However, if Rocha does exactly what you're talking about, and if he gets inside of his own head, if he starts missing a couple questions in that first round, that's not something you want to do against Ethan, because any lead Ethan gets over you, you're in trouble, because you've got to stay on pace with Ethan or you can't come back.
He's a little like Tiger Woods, where a Tiger is going into a Sunday with the lead, look out, unless your name's Y.E. Yang.
Yeah.
But this one, I think that this could be determined, ironically enough, in the third round, in the betting round. If Rocha places all his chips, or three chips, to the center of the table, misses that question, I don't see him coming back from that because he's going to try to make up too much ground in the speed round. That's something that can happen to competitors because you miss a point if you answer an incorrect question in the speed round. He starts buzzing in willy-nilly. Look out, Ethan Irwin could be in the driver's seat at that point.
Well, the thing is, once again, whoever wins this match, whoever is the champion, will be defending against either Clarke Wolfe or Dan Murrell in New York. So, you ready to pick Clarke Wolfe as your winner of the number one contender? You picked Dan Murrell. Excuse me. You picked Dan Murrell.
I picked Murrell.
So, if you had Murrell, who do you have Murrell against? Is it against Ethan in a rematch, or is it Murrell Rocha 3 for the championship in New York? What do you got?
Yeah, in this vid so far, I think I have Knopic taking out Kalinowski. And then here, John Rocha wants this so bad. He has trained for this moment literally his whole life. But it seems like Ethan Irwin has been born and has possessed all this knowledge his entire life. I think Ethan takes it.
You're going with a new champion.
Ethan takes it, and John Rocha, he can walk out of here with his head held high, but his horse to New York will have already taken off.
So Mark is saying that we have a new champion here with, I think that's the only new champion that you have predicted, this one, and I would say I disagree. I think John Rocha is going to keep the title. I think Ethan, under the big lights, I don't know. He's never competed in front of a big crowd before. Every match that he did, even the five-rounder, had to be shot at 9 in the morning because of his schedule and everything, too.
Yeah, a little wizard behind the curtain action.
Well, because it's relevant. It's relevant in the fact that now you're going to be performing in front of all your peers, in front of fans, in front of people, and you're in the main event. You're going to be sitting around waiting, watching. John Rocha's been to this dance many times. John Rocha has been in the live events. He's been in two of them. John Rocha has been in title matches. John Rocha has been the main event at the Collider Collision. Some would argue, the face of the league. And Ethan Irwin is brand new to this. He is a rookie to this. His knowledge, yes, but his experience with the Schmoedown is limited. So I see Rocha edging this out. I see the speed round being a factor, and I see Rocha going to the dance in New York against Clarke Wolfe in the main event.
Well, I see us having a great time at the Schmoedown Spectacular. I can't wait to hear the sounds of the Ninja Turtles song when we're introducing Ethan, because that means that, A, my throat is about to be able to take a rest after so many matches that we're calling, but it also means that we are in for one hell of a main event of the many main events that you're going to see once the Spectacular drops.
All right, now it's up to you guys. Here's what you have to do. First of all, get your tickets to schmoedownlive.com. You can get those tickets to New York today. You're going to see either John Rocha versus either Dan Murrell or Clarke Wolfe, or Ethan Irwin versus either Dan Murrell or Clarke Wolfe, and the undercard match to be announced after the Spectacular.
King Kong versus Godzilla.
That's right. Go ahead and buy those tickets now. But who do you got? Go ahead and list it in the comments. Give us all your predictions. Who wins the Commissioner Bowl? Who wins the team titles? Who's got the number one contender match? Who's got Star Wars? Who's got the Inner Geekdom title match? And who's going to win the singles championship between Andre and Hulk? That's right.
I mean, look, I went mostly chalk with this. You went a little – look, did you make solid, mindful predictions like I did, or did you have a little bit too much booze before you went on camera and you picked it like Kristian did? Let us know right now.
Well, thank you guys for everything. And once again, at the Spectacular, the reveal, the plan for Season 6 will happen. At the end of the match – excuse me, at the end of the event, I'm going to tell everybody the plans of what's going to happen. I have the plan. Know what's going to happen. But also, for all you guys out there who aren't on Patreon, please go and check it out. Look at all the tiers that we offer. www.patreon.com/schmoedown. That's right, patreon.com/schmoedown. Sign up today. Exclusive matches happening. The November match, if you saw it, was the movie release date. December, after the Spectacular, will be the holiday release one. And then in January, I'll announce that at the Spectacular as well.
That is the very cagey Kristian Harloff. I am the always ready to give out any information I may have inside my head. Mark Ellis, make sure you check out the Schmoedown Rundown wherever you get your podcasts, and the Movie Trivia Schmoedown Facebook page as well. Going to be a fun event, partner.
It's going to be a lot of fun, so make sure you guys check it out. Once again, the Schmoedown Spectacular. Join the Facebook group today. Listen to the Schmoedown Rundown as they'll have a full breakdown of everything you're about to see. Check it out. Do it all.
Just said it.
We'll see you next time. I know you did.